Hello and good evening, everyone. This is Devi Shobha from Kitskinta, welcoming you to today's Chaivization series. First of all, wish you all a very, 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 very happy Navratri. This is the festive season in India, and this is a special 10 days to many of us in India. And you know, this is this brings that festive mood, the joyous, you know, the ambience and everything. And it also brings a little bit of serenity and centeredness to all of us. So may the Mother Goddess shower her choicest blessings on all of you. And today we have a very, very special guest, Dr. Madhulika Sagaram with us. Dr. Madhulika, wish you a very, very happy Navratri, first of all, and thank you for joining us today.
Sure. Thank you for having me over. It's a pleasure.
Right. And many of us, you know, we do realize that we have a lot of family rituals very specific to, you know, our families, and we many of us carry special sentiments. And of course, this is the time to create loads of memories with this special time. So we appreciate a lot of that about India. There's a lot of color, there's a lot of festivity and all of that. But I think many of us do not realize that our culture has plenty to offer in terms of, you know, training and learning to pedagogical aids to help us develop critical thinking and nurture our creative sides. And today, Dr. Madhulika Sagaram is here on our Chaivization episode to talk about precisely that. She has a very, very special way of, you know, picking up pedagogical tools from culture, from art, from places, and then integrating all of them to deliver tools for learning. And he has done a remarkable job training thousands of students. And she didn't start off here. She actually started off being a PhD in molecular and environmental plant science. And she followed it up with a triple emphasis in curriculum and instruction, social and leadership development from Texas A&M University in Texas. And then she moved on to innovation in English learning using social language, using local language, culture, and a way of life that has been listed among the top 10 innovations in India and Africa in secondary education. So this is great. I'm hearing a little bit of an echo. Is it because of, I hope all of you are able to hear me well. Dr. Madhulika, are you also hearing that echo?
Yeah. There's some kind of an echo is going on.
Yeah, I don't know. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so this is Dr. Madhulika, and today she is here to, you know, talk about her special pedagogical lineage and how she trains her students. She has a very interesting way of teaching children. My two kids also learn from her and enjoy her classes immensely. She teaches them creative thinking. So, Dr. Madhulika, please let us know. Please start off with, you know, what you should know about, because I don't know where to start. So, you tell us about your special way of learning.
Sure. Essentially, the kind of pedagogy, and let me tell you what pedagogy is. Pedagogy is how we facilitate learning for children. Those approaches are called pedagogy, those methods, you can say. Earlier they used to be called methods, now they are called approaches, because now moving from facilitation in a lot of what we are doing with children of all ages. So this particular pedagogy, specifically what I work with, it's rooted in indigenous learning systems of India. And I think it'll be better if I share screen, that way you all are able to see some visuals. While that is going on, are you able to hear me clearly?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So while I'm able to send this, let me share a little bit about the background, because that doesn't need the presentation. So, I studied in the US, I did my master's, then PhD, then a master's with triple emphasis. And They have an email where I can send it?
Yeah, it's devishobha@kidskinta.com.
S-O-B-H-A or?
S-H-O-B-H-A.
S-H-O-B-H-A.
Yeah. @kidskinta.com, KIDSKINTHE. Yeah.
So I returned in 2010 and I started an organization called Adhya Educational Society. And Adhya Educational Society from 2011 onwards, we did around Hyderabad to see how we can accelerate. When I returned from the US, inherently, intuitively, I had this know-how, this inclination of how learning can happen, because, you know, right from childhood, I kind of was initiated into Tantra at a very early age, at the age of 3. So this knowledge, this understanding, how learning happens for myself also. And stemmed this, what you can say, this whole approach of accelerating learning. So in 2011, I did a couple of pilot projects where I accelerated 8 to 9 grades in about 4 to 5 months. And in 2012, we kind of picked up 120 children at a government school. And then we were able to accelerate 7 grades of English the first year, 8 grades of mathematics the second year, and 9 grades of science the third year. And as a result of that, you know, the work began spreading and the work kind of started reaching a lot more schools, a lot more people. We started doing many other projects and programs. And then the last few years, I started a center called Ajahn Center for Pedagogy. And this Ajahn Center for Pedagogy, I was able to do a lot of work in terms of constructivist pedagogy. Now, when we say constructivist pedagogy in the Western world, there is something called as constructivist pedagogy. So through this constructivist pedagogy, what it facilitates is that the child can construct their own knowledge. So the teacher is not a teacher anymore. The teacher is more like a facilitator than being a typical teacher who is going to tell the child what to do and how to do it, but takes a back seat, allows the child to take the front seat. And as a result, what happens is that the, you know, their faculties, their learning, their understanding, all that becomes much more important, much more integrated. It comes to the fore. They are able to take charge. So the child is not a passive consumer anymore. The child is a knowledge creator. So to understand how this knowledge creation happens, let me just kind of tell you very basics of, you know, like how the animal kingdom is. DEVISHOBHA@kidskinta, right?
Yeah.
Kidskinta.com. Okay. So I sent it. Let's see where that takes us. But anyways, so there are very tiny organisms like protozoa, amoeba, coelenterata, hydras, the mollusks, all kinds of insects, nematodes, all these creatures, their nervous system works in response to external stimulus. If you take plants also, only right. when you remove sunlight right. or water or whatever, they kind of respond back with a stimulus. So their learning is in response to an external stimulus. All these creatures, they don't have a vertebra, so they're called invertebrates. But then there are other creatures called vertebrates, and we are also vertebrates. Fish, amphibians, frogs, reptiles, lizards, snakes, birds, and then mammals and us. We are all vertebrates. So what happened with vertebrates is, as the vertebral column established in the process of evolution, we got a central nervous system.
Right.
So as a result of this central nervous system, we are able to process stimulus inside our body. It's not external anymore, it's internal. So biochemistry came into being. And as a result of this internal stimulus, while those protozoans, the invertebrates, they only have awareness. They have awareness of the external environment. But we have awareness of our internal environment also. We have awareness of the external as well as the internal. This awareness of the internal environment is called consciousness. Awareness of awareness. There is an awareness inside also, just like there is one outside. And we have an awareness of that. So this consciousness, while all living beings have in some capacity, even a stone will have in some capacity, but it's subtle. It's not activated like it is for us. But for us, it is activated because we have the central nervous system and a different functionality. And as a result of this, our learning is very different. And our learning happens through our sensory perceptions. And our learning also becomes conditioning through our sensory perceptions. Now, at Advaita, what we do is we kind of integrate all our faculties together. We have seven different types of, sensory perceptions. They're not five. We typically told it's five. Right. You know, seeing, hearing, tasting, touching, smelling. But then there's two more. If you can go a couple of slides later.
Yeah. Just 1 minute.
Sure. So we have two more. One is called... No, next one. I finished all this. Next one. Yeah, next one. Yeah, sensory differences. So we have... two more called, one is called vestibular balance. This is about listening. Now, hearing and listening are two different things.
Right.
Hearing is related to our ear, whatever we hear. But listening is beyond that. Listening is the ability to take sound and transfer it into an image. This ability is not at all focused in what we call the conventional or the regular school systems. Then the final one, the most important one, is called proprioception. What this means is an understanding of space. There is space inside us, there is space outside us. So understanding that space. So in order to facilitate the vestibular balance and this body awareness, and all our Indian art forms, you know, whether you take our classical forms or you take kalari or even our Rangoli Muggu Kolam,
right.
It is an understanding of space.
Right.
If you don't have an understanding of space, you can't draw it.
Right.
And like I told you, our perception is inside, right?
Right.
So if that understanding doesn't develop inside, you can't draw it outside.
Right.
So all our indigenous systems, they are continuously making this connection between our inside and outside.
Hmm.
this is like at the crux of a lot of things that I do with children. And now can you go back to the first slide so I can very quickly walk everyone through it?
Yeah, just taking a while to open this.
All right. So what we do, my program is called Adbhuta. After starting Adya, which was a non-profit, then starting Ajan, for the past 2 years, I've been trying to see how I can take this out of the non-profit scheme to all children. And this COVID was a wonderful opportunity. I had been trying this approach with children face to face. And last 1.5 years, I don't know, maybe you could just say luck or some foresight or forethought or whatever. I had been trying this online and I was very surprised to see that this works fantastic online. So the reason is, what we do at Adbhuta is we do what is called lateral learning. So we take convergent learning, which is based in, like facts kind of learning. Then we take divergent learning, which is like ideas, and we put it together. So as a result of that, children are able to synthesize and learn instantly. In a synthetic moment, they are able to figure out the process of learning. They are able to, kind of construct the knowledge themselves. So what we do is we involve a lot of art, a lot of Indian cultural aspects, a lot of heritage. We kind of do all this work with children in multitudes of ways. And as we kind of work with children, we kind of enable their capacities. So as you can see in the image, there are several things that happen due to lateral learning. Most important is gestalt. So gestalt is like an aha moment, you know, like when you're reading some books or you're watching a movie, there's certain comics, they show you a bulb, right? That a bulb went on. So we facilitate that going on of the bulb purposely with our pedagogy. Our pedagogy has inbuilt mechanism this is how it is. That happens constantly for the child, continuously for the child. And the whole pedagogy is the focus on the child with very little focus on the facilitator. And the facilitator kind of has to drop their ego. So it's a lot of work on the facilitator's part to allow the child to be, allow the child in their natural state to access their possibilities, their faculties, their potentials. And that is what we kind of facilitating. Devi, will you be able to move? Few slides. If it's not, yeah, there you go. Here, this is good. So we have four faculties. We have our body, we have our emotion, we have our mind, we have our energy. So the typical regular Western model of system that we call the conventional system now, in the West, they only look at the mind as the most important thing. But our culture is not like that. We give equal import. I mean, we consider our body the most important, because I must, some of you at least must have heard about the panchakoshas, right? We look at our body in 5 different aspects. I'm going to show the methodology to you in the next slide. Then we have this body, which is related to the doing aspect. And according to research, 78% of children are kinesthetic, meaning they learn through their body. And what is our regular system doing? Engaging them through the mind. And then we say the child is below average, the child is average, they cannot learn. No, what we are doing with the child, the adults are below average. Children are never below average. Children are exceptionally brilliant. Adults are below average because adults have been conditioned already. So what we are doing is we are taking taking our conditioning and offering it to the child. Then all our experiences happen in our body space. So majority of children learn through experiences only. Sensory perception is very clear for children. It's not muddied like it is for us. So our pedagogy keeps the sensory perception intact, clear. Then we engage with the child in helping them drop unnecessary emotions. Then we also work with the child in understanding their energy, because through energy, awareness is possible. This awareness is possible. Understanding of awareness is also possible. So all these four faculties, we bring it together. And mind does not refer to brain. I don't know why there is a huge groups of people think mind is brain. Mind refers to senses, all your senses, the bundle of senses, all the sensory organs, especially the skin, because the skin is distributed across the body. And that is the most important aspect of mind, which is why touch is the most fundamental of all sensory perceptions. Even little children, they learn only through touch first. Vision also comes later. As soon as a child is born, the child starts learning through touch. And after that, vision comes. So the mind is sensory organs. Brain is one small component of it. So typically what is being done at schools is the whole focus is on the brain, when brain is like maybe 3-4%, and rest of 90%+ is not being touched at all. Children are made to sit when the majority of them learn through movement, learn through understanding of their space, their awareness. So our approach, even though we are offering online, we are enabling children to understand all these faculties. And that is the beauty of the indigenous learning systems. And like I told you, I knew all this from childhood because of my engagement with Tantra and my own learning. And in 2016, for about 2 years, I lived like a sadhu, a sannyasi, traveling across India, documenting all the indigenous learning systems and trying to identify what is it that we can use. Because all the Waldorfs and Montessoris are very nice, but we learned before all this came to India, right? It's not like we were an illiterate culture. Right. It's a very advanced culture. So why is it that we are not using any of it anymore? And see, Montessori would be very suitable for Italians. Waldorf would be most suited for Germans because it is their cultural context. Likewise, what is indigenous to our culture would be most appropriate for us.
Right.
Why are we not using our own system? So that is the premise behind what I'm doing. Can we go next slide and next slide?
Yeah, sure.
I think I've done the sensory differences. Perhaps we can go to the next one. Yeah. So all of us, we accumulate conditioning during the first 8 years of our life. First 4 years, we accumulate conditioning from our mother. The next 4 years, 4 years to 8 years, we accumulate conditioning from our father. And there is a model called Bronfenbrenner's ecological systems model. That is what the circles are. And according to this model, there is a microsystem, there is a mesosystem, there is an exosystem. And what these systems are, the microsystem is the family, parents, grandparents, friends, whatever. The mesosystem is more like the tuition, the extracurricular classes, the dance classes, swimming classes, the hospital, the engagement at the local community park, playtime, whatever. Then the next level is extended framework, where let's say the parents go to work and then they learn conditioning through their work environment. Somebody, you know, Mr. Sharma is doing something, so Mr. Jitender also wants to do the same thing. That kind of stuff we learn. And then peer pressure also comes there. Then finally, media, what we read, what we see, what we engage with, all this forms our personality and how we approach learning. And right now, with so much focus on technology, we have to balance technology with experience, with hands-on learning. Just the teacher saying something on one side, the child is not going to be able to learn it. So our pedagogy at Adbhuta, it creates a balance between technology and experience, at the same time addresses all the issues of conditioning. Can we see the next slide, Devisho? Yeah. So my research, and this is published in the International Handbook of Critical Pedagogy. So this research is now book content for bachelor's in education programs for teachers in 120 countries. So wow.
Amazing.
Yeah. So thousands of teachers across the world are going to learn and use this. So what I figured out is that children are like Google. Children and adults learn differently. I'll tell you how also. All children are like Google. You know, they collect data. What does Google do? You type something. It collects that data and then it puts it into a pocket. So children are like that. They collect data, then they put one into a green pocket, one into a blue pocket, one into a purple pocket. And then they associate different ideas. And based on prior experience, whatever prior experience they have been given, they associate different ideas. And that we call knowledge. And as these association of ideas continues again and again and again, due to follow-up experience, insights happen. So it's like we have those potli bags, no? We take when we go to functions. It has a string. If you pull it, it closes right. With whatever is inside. But if you pull it very tight, it'll break.
Right.
So this is just like that. Children are like that. So they kind of put all the information, they keep making connections, then they pull it, and as that thread breaks, you know, that aha moment happens for them.
Mm-hmm.
And you can actually make this aha moment happen for them as a teacher. And that is the pedagogy. So in conventional schooling, where is the teacher doing all this for the child?
Mm-hmm.
This is not happening. Next slide, please. So here is my method. This is once again published in the International Handbook of Critical Pedagogy. So I work with children at five different levels. So because of the indigenous pedagogy system, I take the panchakosha. We have five koshas. The first kosha is called annamaya kosha, our physical body. Anna is the food we eat, our physical body, what we can touch. And to address that kosha, all these are memory bodies. To address that kosha, I work with proprioception and kinesthetics. I told you about the two sensory perceptions, right? Understanding awareness of space and balance. Balance comes from vestibular balance, listening, ability to listen. I facilitate that at the body level. Then at the energy level, I use art, culture, heritage, and create experiences for the child. I enable them to create experiences for themselves. A very good example would be Devi's children. They're a part of the high school program. And very recently I gave them a question where it was a poem, a poetic story with a series of columns. Suddenly in between, a column is missing. And then again, columns are there. So they have to figure out what that column is.
Right.
To figure out what that column is, it's very mathematical. It involves a lot of critical thinking, creativity. So it's embedded in art, culture, heritage, but also creates a personal experience. And there are many ways you can create that. You can put columns in that space. So one child would make a column one way, the other will make another way. So then they are also able to engage with each other and see how different multiple possibilities are present for the same question. Because see, in the conventional system, they give you one question, one answer. But it is never like that in life. Every question in life has many answers. So for 25 years, you're training a child to understand that there is only one answer for the question, then suddenly you get married, and then what happens? One answer doesn't work. You go to your office, one answer doesn't work. Then comes the emotion body. So you can't separate the mind body and emotion body, the manomay kosha and the vijnanamay kosha. So I address them together. I work on the perceptions, the conditioning the child has through creation of sublime learning environments, emotional development through complicated conversations. And this is a lot of work I do on myself. This is more like a spiritual practice, this whole pedagogy, because I have to drop my emotion. And all my kids, no matter what their age, I teach from 3 years to 18 years. And my 3-year-old thinks I'm 3. My 7-year-old thinks I'm 7. Mm-hmm. My 14-year-old thinks I'm 14. And that is possible because of this emotional development I facilitate through complicated conversations. I take very complex issues and, you know, through conversation, make it very simple for them. And I don't know how many of you have heard about this, but we have scripture, a shastra called Yoga Vashishta. So Rama, when he is 14 years old, Vishwamitra comes to take him to kill Tataka. And Rama is disillusioned, like Buddha gets disillusioned. And he says, what is this world full of misery? What is the meaning of this world? So he asks Vashishta a series of questions about awareness, about consciousness, about the body, about the sensory perceptions, about the reality of the world. And because Vashishta is talking to a 14-year-old boy, he tells many stories. And these stories are in many dimensions of time, space. I mean, it's phenomenal literature. So I use that pedagogy. My pedagogy is Vashishta's pedagogy.
Amazing.
Yeah. And in the West also, this pedagogy is there. It's called Carrere. And all my professors come from that line. As a result of using Vashishta's pedagogy coupled with all the proprioception or the art, culture, heritage experience I'm doing, the child's emotional baggage diminishes. So all the trauma they have accumulated, all the conditioning, all the nonsense they have accumulated since childhood gets washed off. So there is enormous space inside. So when this space is available inside, then you can integrate mind, body, emotion, energy. If you're already full of stuff, think of it like this. You're like a basket. And from childhood, everybody has put whatever into that basket. And if the basket is full, can anything new be put into it? It cannot be put. So you have to empty the basket first, so that something new can be put. So that also the pedagogy facilitates, so that the child can drop all the ridiculous nonsense that they have accumulated from their environment and actually fill themselves up with many possibilities for themselves. Can we go to the next slide, Devi?
Yeah.
So there are three stages of learning. The first stage is unconscious incompetence, where a person, and this is how adults learn. Adults, majority of their life, from about the time you become 21 until mid-age, you know, till you hit a midlife crisis. And some people hit midlife crisis in 40s. Some people hit midlife crisis in 60s. So till an adult hits midlife crisis, an adult functions only in unconscious incompetence, lack of awareness of body, emotion, mind, and energy. So majority of teachers that are functioning in unconscious incompetence are facilitating unconscious incompetence for the child. Mm-hmm. Further on, training the child to become unconscious. The child that is conscious is being turned into unconscious. Then the teacher will hit conscious incompetence, unmindful awareness. First, lack of awareness, then unmindful awareness. We can also call this consciously unconscious. Then finally, the teacher will hit conscious competence, really being conscious. But by then, already the damage has been done, right?
Right.
This is the teacher's learning process, and this is very different from the child's learning process. So we have to teach children differently. We can't teach children the way we learn. Everybody is teaching children the way we learn, and that is where the damage is. So I am ensuring that is not happening. That is what is special about the Indian pedagogy. Our rishis, munis, and our ancient people, they knew this. And because of knowing this, they kind of had a whole different Gurukula system, right?
Yeah.
So if Gurukula was not just a place where a child went. Guru's Kula it was. Kula doesn't mean caste or whatever. That is nonsense. That's a very corruption of the word Kula. Kula means pedagogy. So every guru had a certain kula. Vashishta's kula of complicated conversations, like I told you. Vishwamitra's kula was mantra. Agastya's kula was energy work. Agastya never spoke to a disciple. Just sit with the disciple, transfer everything through energy. Prashnavalkya, his was neti, negation of negation. Negate till whatever is real remains. Like in modern times, Jiddu Krishnamurti does that very well. You ask Jiddu Krishnamurti, what is love? For 2 hours, he will tell you what is not love. So you remove item one, item two gone, item three gone, item 100 gone. Whatever is left, that is love. So every rishi, every guru had a certain pedagogy, and that is Gurukula. So I am working on bringing back the kulas of tantra, which are actually the integration of this mind, body, emotion, energy, awareness. Can we go to the next slide, please?
Absolutely.
So how we run the Adbhuta program is we have a program for primary years, typically 5 to 9 years, and then we have a middle school program, and then we have a high school program. In the primary years program, we have 3 different units. Each unit goes on for 3 to 4 months based on the children's progress. Right now, I have 2 groups of primary years children, and we were able to complete 4 months of whatever we were supposed to do in 3 months. So we're moving into the next unit very quickly. So first unit was about survival. Second unit is about power. The third unit is about love and relationships, and all of it is interconnected. So whatever they have learned in food and nutrition will be connected to Panchabhutas, because what they ate in food becomes their body, right? Like that. So next slide, please. And we use quite a bit of origami. All our primary years children are also able to do phenomenal origami, quite high order origami. And the reason we decided to use origami is because that complicated conversation is possible, the connection of the emotion, body, mind, and energy happens fantastic with origami, and children learn to surrender to material. You know, in dropping their ego, they no longer think they will fold the paper. They learn to surrender to the paper so the paper may fold itself. Right. And that creates phenomenal space, phenomenal creativity, phenomenal potential. So right from childhood, they learn to harness the energy of nature. Next slide, please. This is the program for the middle years, the 4 months of balance, then 4 months of diversity, then 4 months of patterns. We focus quite a bit on patterns because mathematics is patterns. If you look at ancient Indian systems, math was not a subject. Maths was the pedagogy. Mathematics was based in identification of patterns. Even if our people, Indians were considered very good with numbers, but even in numbers, our people only found patterns. Because all of life happens in mathematical patterns. All of psychology, human psychology, happens in mathematical patterns. It's connected to the rotation, revolution of the moon, the sun, and the earth, all of it, everything. Whatever happens in the cosmos happens inside us. Our life goes along with solar and lunar cycles. Even menstrual cycles of women are on lunar cycles, right? So every 12 years, the sun's magnetic pole shifts. So every 12 years, our life shifts one way and then comes back again. So every 21 years, there's a shift in our life. So these patterns, if children learn from childhood, no matter what happens to them in their life, they can manage their life. They can unlearn, relearn very fast.
It's a lot of emotional grounding.
Emotional grounding, emotional development, a lot of self-confidence, phenomenal stretch of ability. Can we see the next slide? I'll show you how that acceleration happens.
Yeah, sure.
So we also create what we call a portfolio. So I document the child's learning and I create an online portfolio every week through which I map how the child is progressing, and there's close to 40-50 different parameters I will measure in every unit. Every 4 months, I will measure a new set of 40-50 parameters. So in 1 year, 120-150 parameters for physical development, emotional development, social development, psychological development. Typically, schools never do all this, right? So measure that and provide that. And we also do what is called as journey mapping, which is phenomenal. Can we go to the next slide?
Yeah, I know that you've done the journey maps for my kids also. So I would like
Right. So this is a six-year-old just showing her creativity. We were designing bed sheets, and this child just decided to go pick up fallen leaves and flowers and create a bed sheet out of it. And look at the play of colors. Look at the opening of creativity. Can we go to the next slide, please? And middle school children, we studied 13 different kinds of Ramayana in July and August. And here they are understanding multiple perspectives, because there is a Ramayana where Sita kills Ravana. There's a Ramayana where Vibhishana kills Ravana. There is one where Lakshmana kills Ravana. There's any 300 kinds of Ramayanas, out of which we studied 13 important ones. And then they identified and did critical thinking on what other possibilities were there for Ravana other than doing what he did. So here, and see, the reason why I put this is a 10-year-old child. And because of all the news she had been watching about Sushant Singh Rajput's death, she has drawn Ravana hanging himself. This nuance came out, and then I did a complicated conversation with all the children about that. So whatever a child sees, hears, smells, touches is a part of them.
Right.
Can we go to the next slide, please? We do a lot of origami. A lot of our children start doing very high order stuff. Next slide. Our journey maps. Let's look at Enoch's journey map. So this child is from Santiago, Chile. Now, the online opportunity has opened up this platform for children across the globe. So I have an evening batch, which is children from other countries. And this child is from Santiago, Chile, and end of June, look at his drawing on the top. He's a 9-year-old, but his drawing was like a 3-year-old. End of August, just two months. End of August, look at the ability to draw.
Yeah.
So what was with this child is that all children, I mean, society at large, even adults are stuck with their emotions in adolescence or toddler years. It's not surprising that a 9-year-old would be stuck at 3. So in just 2 months, I was able to move the child's emotion to 9. As I moved the child's emotion to 9, the child started drawing, writing like a 9-year-old. He started writing just like that. Everything is related to emotion.
Great. So when you say moving emotion, you facilitate it through conversations and all of these different pedagogical tools.
That's I showed you the method, right?
Right.
So through that method, I moved the child 6 years in 3 months.
Awesome.
Emotionally.
So naturally, there's an increase in confidence and emotional connections and all of that. Resilience.
Right. So if you're not able to connect emotionally, what will you learn? No matter what is given to you, what is shown to you, what is facilitated for you, you will only learn at the level of 3 years, wherever you are stuck. You can't learn more.
Right.
The next one, Gavin, he is from London, and he's 6 now. And after he started working with origami and paper, he's building his own toys. See, he built some transformer thing, the red one. Then he created his own laptop and his headphone to play with. And he made a dress for his mom. And apparently his mother was complaining to his father saying, "You didn't buy me that ring that you were supposed to." And he quickly made a ring for her. He said, "There you go. You have it." And end of July, look at his drawing, and end of early September, his drawing also, kind of, just look at that, end of July and early September.
There's so much of emotional nuance to this picture here.
Right, emotional nuance, physical nuance. So whatever changes are happening in the child will depict it outside.
Right.
Next. This is Lalita from Singapore. She's 10 and phenomenal emotional development within her. She went from being a very timid, shy child that didn't want to draw anything at all in June ending to early September. She became a pro at drawing, painting, at being able to talk in front of an audience.
Wow.
Next, please. This is Ansh, who is from Hyderabad, and he has developed phenomenal willingness to unlearn. He was very rigid early on. Now he has developed phenomenal ability to unlearn and lot of capacity, awareness about the body. See, he has used Varli art. We did Varli art with the middle. Look at the Varli art and how he has interpreted yoga poses.
Yeah, this Chakrasana is awesome.
Right. Yeah. So his understanding of body, look at the body awareness he has understood.
Right.
And all this is happening online, right? I'm not meeting him. Can we go to the next slide, please? So we also have programs for older kids, like Devi's children in high school. So we have a program where I facilitate critical thinking for first 4 months. Then I facilitate originality and innovation for the next 4 months and creative writing for the next 4 months. So right now, her children are going through the critical thinking module and experience. Next slide, please. So this is Devi's daughter Ananya, and here are some samples of her expressing herself. Both her children have been participating and doing a lot of wonderful stuff, phenomenally creative stuff, phenomenally, engaging interface they have created for their own learning. They're kind of engaging with learning in a very different way from what they have been used to in their school. The next slide. This is Ameya, her other daughter. And you see how they're just 1.5 years apart, but look at their interests. Their potentials are very different. Now look at that small skirt made out of paper. Mm-hmm. Can you believe that it is made out of paper? It's so phenomenal, right? So that is the potential that came out. And none of the kids knew muggus and rangolis, but after that exercise, they kind of figured out the math of it, the design of it. And then we talked about a little about history and anthropology around those muggus and kolams. And Ameya went on to design many, it's like a mini wardrobe. She has made many jackets, skirts, dresses, coats, shirts, everything out of paper. Next one, please. So apart from this, I also work with children, helping them understand what kind of career possibilities are there for them and how they should go about it. Because I think this is one area which there's a huge lacuna in India. Because psychometric test or whatever is relevant only at that particular point. So you take some, do a psychometric test, take some, you know, it gives you a result, you pick up a subject. By the time you're done with 12th grade, you're different.
Yeah, what do you? Yeah.
Right. So this is like more based in Indic psychology, so you can figure out your life. Then I also have a pedagogy club where some parents have started, those interested in doing research have started doing research to be able to publish. I'm training them how to write. And then November, I'm also starting a training, 6 months training program for all those that are interested in learning the pedagogy. And then I also have workshops on learning better, faster. I want now to kind of, for people to learn how to learn better, faster, because it's just a matter of understanding how to create space. Only when you drop your emotion, your ego, all the conditioning you have accumulated, you create space, only then you can learn. So I want to be able to help as many children as I can, as many teachers as I can, as many parents I can, with the pedagogy, and that's pretty much my story.
Thank you, Dr. Madhulika. This was such a wonderful talk, and I think just thinking about the possibilities, right? It is so exciting, and
right,
and the kind of work that has gone into this, just to conceptualize and, you know, bring it to a level where you can break it down and actually deliver it in modules to all kinds of people and all kinds of backgrounds and all kinds of ages. I think you've done such a phenomenal job. Thank you for all the work and all the insights you bring in. I mean, this is a heartfelt thanks. I'm sure I am seeing a lot of comments here also saying this is such amazing work and awesome interaction. Thank you so much. And to all the listeners and the viewers who have been following Dr. Madhulika's talk, her work is just extraordinary, as you can see. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. She offers a lot more. And I'm looking forward to bringing her, with her permission, looking forward to bringing her on to another summit that Kids Kinta is organizing in February. Definitely. So Purva, from the audience is asking, please, can you share about the courses? Purva, yes, definitely. We will be very, very
happy. Maybe the last slide is my email and phone number. Maybe you can put the last slide so they can contact me.
Yeah, absolutely. So one sec. The last slide.
the next one after this.
Yeah, so this is the contact. So anyway, people who are interested, I will also share Dr. Madhulika's contact via email, and I'll also be putting this talk up on our YouTube channel, and it will also be available here for further viewing. So thank you very much, Dr. Madhulika. This was such a wonderful experience. And to all the viewers and listeners, this is Kitskintha's flagship Chaivization series. Please join us to meet more, many more wonderful people like Dr. Madhulika Sagaram. You can log on to kitskintha.com/chaivizationsregister so that you never, never miss meeting such wonderful people. Have a good day, and very, 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 very happy Navratri once again. And wishing you a great time ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me, Navadevi. Wonderful experience.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Madhulika. It's absolutely amazing. Thank you.
Thank you. Take care, everyone. Wonderful talking here on this platform.